Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Dr. TLA Plus series lecture again. Today, it's our great pleasure to have Rustin Leno give a lecture on global snapshots. So I got to know Rustin through another project we work with Iron Fleet team. So the Iron Fleet team has been helping the Azure Storage team designing and approving a consensus protocol. And then the entire Iron Fleet framework is built on top of the language Daphne, which Rustin developed. And then later on, I got to know that Rustin did his PhD at Caltech and with Chandi. And then so in terms of teaching global snapshots, so besides Chandi or Lamport, I think Rustin is probably the best person that we can learn snapshot from, right? So without further ado, Rustin.
All right, thank you very much. Thank you for those kind words. I have not talked about Chandi's work outside Caltech since I graduated. So this will be a fun time for me as well. Okay. I'm going to tell you about global snapshots, and there are a lot of formal details that you could include, and I'm going to try to stay as informal as I can, though I'll try to be precise. So, what is a a plug for the book that I was so keen on reviewing for these lectures as well. It's a wonderful book. I'm sure it's not in print, but I'm not sure if it's available or not. But if you have a copy, I would recommend reading it. So what is a global snapshot? A global snapshot is a recording of all of the variables of all of the state of a program, think of it as the state of a computation, if you like. The computation can be spread across many different machines. It could be in one machine with shared memory, or it could be distributed and have channels and whatever it is. And you might want to have a global snapshot because if you want to restart the system from some point, then if you know some consistent state where the program may have been, then you can just attempt to roll back to that state and start from there. You can also detect certain conditions. For example, if you'd like to detect deadlocks, or if you want to detect some other anomalies, like a token ring algorithm has some number of tokens that are floating around in the system. And if you're afraid that some token might be lost, then the total number of tokens is going to be reduced. And so both deadlocks and something like tokens like that are stable conditions. That is, once they occur, they're always going to be you're always going to be in that state. So if that's something you'd like to detect, if you just take a global snapshot, if it is consistent, then you can detect. If you find the condition in the snapshot, you know that it still persists. Okay, so I'm going to give an example, and it's going to be a favorite example from this Dr. TLA Plus series. So it will be a bank. The bank has a certain things that we need to be aware of. There are accounts. So here I'm showing a few accounts. And each account has some balance. I'm not thinking that we're recording the history or the transactions that led to that balance, but I'm just going to keep it simple and just think of that each account has some balance. Now, in the system, if you think of a bank, if you use that analogy, there are going to be a number of customers. So the customers are going to be processes in the system that are going to provide requests for the system. So the requests are what are going to drive the computation. So they are like events in the system. So the requests that I'm going to consider for the example are all transfers. So a property of a transfer is that the total amount of money still stays the same. So if you transfer from one account and put it into another account, the total amount of money in the system remains the same. Here I've shown just two colors where the requests come from, but that's not as important for the talk itself. Okay, so if this is the system that we have, then we can conceptually think about what's the history of the program. That is, as these requests are processed, we can think of them as if they happen in a particular order, we can, in our mind, sort of imagine taking a snapshot of the system. And it may look something like this. So here I'm depicting the three accounts, which are the state of the system, and the different amounts that the state would have in time. So I say that it's conceptual history because you may never have it. And I mean, if you think too hard about these things with relativity and things, where can you actually, is there such a thing as the simultaneous moment where all of these things are going to hold? We don't know. But we'd like to, for the sake of thinking about the problem, it's fine to think of there conceptually as being a history of these things so that we can take and describe a snapshot. Okay. So here is then the snapshot, which I'm depicting at the bottom of the slide. So the snapshot is just some number of variables that we're going to copy the state of the world into. So since the state of this bank system is just three integers, I just have room for three integers in the snapshot. But the snapshot also keeps track of whether or not it has recorded something, which is easy to do on the slide. If it's blank, it means it has not been recorded yet. In a real system, you could decide on this granularity yourself. Maybe it is at the granularity of specific accounts in a bank system. If you think of a SQL database, perhaps something like that, or maybe the states that you're recording are the states of entire machines, so that you record all of that state and how you do that. And of course, you would not make a full copy of things. You probably have some incremental way that you could store these things and record them. But for the purposes of these slides, I'm just thinking that you have some variables and you're going to copy them entirely into the snapshot. Okay. So here's one possible snapshot that we could imagine. That is, so in this conceptual state, we've taken a snapshot of all three variables and placed them in the snapshot. And of course, that's rather optimistic that we would be able to do that. We could do this if this is if it's a sequential system. We can just stop the entire world. That is, we have full control over the processor, and we can stop that in some way and then record a snapshot. But of course, the more interesting algorithms have to do where you cannot stop everything, or it would be too expensive to stop everything. Okay, so let's go through one example and see how this goes. Okay, so imagine that we have an initial state where all of the accounts have $100 in them, and the snapshot has not recorded anything yet. So here's a request, that is a statement, if you will, an instruction to do something with the system, an event coming in, and it says to transfer $40 from A to C. Now, if you think about how is that actually going to be done, because this mentions two variables, A and C. To implement this, you need some kind of lock, perhaps, where you lock the variables involved, or maybe you have some sort of transaction system that lets you try the transaction and then roll back if it doesn't complete successfully. So those details I'm not going to be concerned with. That is, I'm just going to think of that a request is something that touches some number of variables, and they can all happen simultaneously. That is, the synchronization involved in that is a different story. Okay, so after that transfer, the balance of the entire system then is 60, 100, 140. Okay, so we can now imagine that we're going to take a snapshot. If we could stop the entire world and take a snapshot of everything, that would be very easy, and then we would be done. But that would be inefficient. So we're imagining that that the snapshots can be taken, that is, the recording can be done only at some granularity. And here I'm picking the same granularity for that as I've picked for the variables themselves. So we can imagine that for some reason, something in the system decides to record some variable somewhere. And here in this case, it's going to record the state of the account C. Just how that is done and coordinated depends, of course, on the algorithm. OK, so if this continues like that, we have a record of variable C. And here's another request to transfer from B to C. And we can now imagine taking yet another snapshot of a part of the system. And so we're imagining that we're copying, we're recording variable A into the snapshot. And then as a third transaction, we're transferring the $70 from C to A. And then at some point, we record the B variable as well. Now, in my example, these two alternate. That is, there's a request and recording a system. But that's just an accident of the example. These could happen in any kind of order. OK, so clear so far? All right. So now we have a snapshot of something. That is, we have three pieces of snapshot that we've put together. And do we like it? Is this a good snapshot?
No.
No. And why don't you like it?
I think the total sum is different from the one we started with.
That's right. The total sum is different. So so because our system has the property, that is, if it's functioning, of course, that the balance is always the same in the entire world, we would expect at least that the that would also be a property of the snapshot, and that's not the case here, which is too bad because the algorithm was so simple. At any time, record a little piece of the system, and then eventually we're done. But this was not a good idea. Okay, so let's not do that one. So what we need to do is we need to put our finger on just what is it in an algorithm like this that makes it good or makes it bad. That is, what is it that we actually want? But it seems again that the invariant property of the balance staying the same is something that we would like. Okay, let's consider another example. Here I've thrown in a fourth account as well. So, and I've recorded in the history on the right, I've shown you in which states I've recorded which pieces of data into the snapshot. So that seems to have happened at two different places here. We should discuss whether or not we like this snapshot. But an observation about it at first is that the snapshot that we got is not a state that ever occurred. That is, if we look at the conceptual history, this state that was recorded, if it's good or not, we'll have to decide. But this state never occurred. So we need to consider, is it OK to have a state that never occurred? If it's not OK to have a state that didn't ever occur, that is, we need to take some care, of course, in what sort of states we would allow. But if we would never allow that, then it's very difficult to see how you would achieve the snapshot without really stopping the entire world. Because when you're recording some piece of the system, other pieces of the system may change. So it would be very difficult to achieve if you're not allowed this. Okay, so what do we think? Allowing us to record some state that isn't actually ever part of the execution seems necessary somehow. But we need to think about what makes such a state good or not. And what do you think about this one? Do you like it or not? Would you accept it as a snapshot? It has the invariant property of the balance. That's good, at least.
Probably no.
Okay, and why not?
Because these were taken at different means. These are snapshots of different variables taken at different point of time. So somehow, if we can take snapshots for different variable at different point of time, but overall that value for each variable exists for any one of the actual time, then it might be a good idea. But right now what we see is like, okay, we have these snapshots, some is consistent, but it's not same for all the variables at one time.
Right. So it's right, which is this thing that the snapshot that we have is not a state that occurred at any time in the conceptual history. But we need to allow that somehow. But if we, and this has the property that if you just look at each column, well, each value here actually did come from some column. But in, let me flip back to the previous slide, that was also the case here, and we didn't like this one. So do we like this one or not? Yeah.
So what's the purpose of taking snapshots? Are we going to restore to some previous state or?
Right, excellent question. So a couple of the goals that we have is one goal would be that we would be able to restore to a state and continue execution from there. So then we need to think about, well, what exactly, I mean, does that mean? And how we think of that is going to depend on what it is that we actually record and how we model things formally if we want to prove the correctness. And the other one is to be able to detect stable conditions. So that is, if we have a condition that we know to be stable, let's say deadlock, if we detect the deadlock in this situation, then we would want to be able to conclude that whenever the system has continued running since then, we'd like to be able to then conclude that in the current state, the deadlock is still there. So that's another purpose of the algorithm.
Well, is it maybe that you would want to be able to, any snapshot you take should be reachable from the transactions that occurred beforehand?
That seems very good, right. So if you think of that the snapshot that you take should be reachable from, from something in the past, that seems good. Because if we just come up with values that perhaps satisfy this invariant of the balance being the, whatever it was, that doesn't seem so good. We'd like there to be some way that we could have gotten there, even if we didn't. In this case, we didn't actually get there in this computation. Yeah.
So it also depends, like in this slide you have this history of transactions in a specific order.
Yeah.
You haven't really told us where this is coming from.
But
and that matters, right?
Yeah,
because somebody may have issued these without any idea in what order they executed. Or they may know and expect a certain order of these to be happening.
That's right. Yeah. Indeed. So those are good considerations. And I would say that because I was silent about that here. If we decide that in our system that matters, that is, that the order has to be preserved in some sort of way, in fact, if the order had to be preserved exactly, we might not really like this snapshot. But that may also mean that in the snapshot, maybe we would actually want to include something about the transactions themselves. That is to say, here are the transactions that we've seen and executed so far. Maybe that should also be part of the transaction. And for the example I'm considering, I'm not considering that to be part of a snapshot. I'm just going to think of the requests coming in, and we process them, and then there's some state at any time, and we're going to try to make a consistent view of that. Okay, so there are different opinions on this one. In the specification that I will give in a while, this would be an okay snapshot. That is, this would be something that would be accepted. For reasons that Dan was getting to. Okay, let's consider a different example. What about this snapshot? Or, well, I shouldn't call it a snapshot. But what about this recording of states? You've all checked that it has the invariant that the total amount of money is 300. That's a good start. So what's different between this one and the previous examples we saw?
This one has a value that never occurred.
That's right. It has a value that never occurred. I mean, so in the previous example, the entire snapshot was a state that never occurred. But in fact, this one even has a value that never occurred. So 70 was never the balance of C. So what do we think of that? Is that a good snapshot? Would we be happy with this one? Well, we don't know. I mean, we have to also think about what is the specification? What is a global snapshot? So if you thought 15 minutes ago that, oh, global snapshot, it's easy. You just specify that at some point there was a state and we just record that. That is the specification. I hope that these slides, these examples have impressed on you that just getting the specification right is, well, both of all, very important. Both it's very important and it's difficult because the there's a lot of room for just coming up with what is it actually that we want. And if you think that that's difficult, then I mean writing the program without the specification would be walking blindfolded, right? So you'd like to have a blueprint of where you're going first. That is a specification that tells you what the program is supposed to do. Well, this one, by the way, you could argue also is correct if you do the following. I can do so easily in PowerPoint. If we consider that, well, this would, if we just change the order of those two, this could have been an execution. And so then it depends on, well, what does our system allow? Would it allow us to reorder things? And here, if you just think of that, maybe all of the blue requests coming from one customer, they have to be ordered. So we're not allowed to swap the order of, among them. But we can swap the order of transactions between the blue and the green customer, for example. So if that's something we're allowed, then this seems like a fine snapshot because there is a reordering of events that would have given us exactly the snapshot in one state here. Okay. All right. So let's think about the specification. And so I'm going to try to be informal about this. But there's much fun to be had to writing it down formally in TLA Plus or other systems. So first to name a few things. So we consider that we have some initial state and. Actually, you don't really want to consider the initial state of the system. You really want to consider the initial state of starting when you start taking the snapshot, because probably the system would have run for a long time before it. But what I mean here, just for the simplicity of the slides, is the initial state is the state where you start taking the snapshot. And then we have some current state. And the current state, again, I'm now thinking the conceptual state in the history, if you allow us to think that way. So there were some number of events that I've shown in blue and green so far. And we can think of the sequence of that event, the sequence of those events. Or depending on your system and what you care about, you can think of them as a set of events. In fact, if the events themselves include some sort of timestamps, you can always think of them as a set of events instead of a sequence of events. That is, you just when you formally model it or when you think about it, you just pack more information into the events so that they become unique, so that the order themselves of the event doesn't matter. Again, that's what you would do when you model things formally. Okay, so here's a specification that I propose. So the global snapshot algorithm is correct if the recorded state satisfies the following property, that there is a way to get from the initial state to the recorded state, which is what Dan suggested. And furthermore, you can get from the recorded state to the current state, because you want that one as well. And you also want to make sure that when we talk about that you can get to, well, what does that mean? You could always get to it by just going and changing the variables. Well, that's perhaps not what your program would have done. So we'd like to say that the how you get there comes from some set of events that are subsets of the original events. So one way that you can think of this is that if you think of E as being a set of statements or a set of events or a set of instructions that can fire at any time, and maybe they're encoded in such a way that they can really just be fired in maybe in certain positions when the program counter is such and such, then the U and V should be from the same language of things. Okay. So this is, I would say, a specification of global snapshot. Yeah, Chris?
Are you allowed to replay a
events?
So, yes, you can replay events if you if you encode the events in such a way that that let's say that the program counter is in it, and if the if you say that the event fires only if the program counter is 8, then it's fine to replay it, because if the program counter is no longer 8, it's just a no-op. And in if you use TLA plus, you would frequently write antecedents of the logical the two-state actions that depend on things like that. So it's nice if you can encode the events, the actions, in such a way that they can be replayed. So if they cannot, then you'd have to think of these as being some sort of subsequences. It's also nice if they have the program counter built in like that. Then we can consider E to be the entire program. That is, maybe things that haven't been actually really executed yet either, because if there's some program counter of the future that we haven't reached yet, that's fine as well. Otherwise, maybe in your specification, you'd like to, if you want to keep that as a sequence, maybe you'd like to model the system as whenever something new happens, that you at that moment record the action that took place. For example, you could imagine formally modeling things so that when you get the new request from a bank customer, that at that moment you formally model it as that you remember what that request is. In other words, enlarging the set E or the sequence E.
So, yep. I think one interesting thing that I didn't realize immediately is that the program could be very restrictive as to what event sequences it allows, right?
Yep, that's right.
So if they say we have the transaction sequence, it could contain something saying that it has to be in a certain order, mm-hmm. or it could not.
That's right.
It could be very selective. Those two could be concurrent, while those other two have to be sequential.
Indeed.
So at the general level, the program would be a set of traces of events.
Right.
And we don't know anything more about the semantics than that. And that is actually sufficient to define this notion of snapshot.
That's right. Because in that case, you would have the same sort of restrictions on the U and V.
Yeah.
That the that if it's important to keep certain things, for example, that the events coming from one customer are not allowed to be reordered, well, that then had better be the case also for U and V.
Exactly.
Yep. Right. Okay, so this is the, I mean, what I'm showing here on the slide is I mean, text and a few symbols, but this I hope gives you an idea of how you would start to think about the formal modeling of it, to write down if you want to write down in TLA plus or some other formal system what exactly is going on, that you think about those sorts of things. Okay, so you would also probably like to say something about termination, that eventually this global snapshot will complete, and I won't really say anything more about that, but the in this particular case, that's much simpler. It turns out that if you want to prove algorithms of global snapshot, Chandy and Misra note in their book that just about all algorithms follow this rule, and they call it rule R. So I call it rule R as well, and it is that when an event, that is, think of an event again as like a request or something coming in, something that you're doing, a statement that you're executing. When an event takes place, it's either the case that all of the variables that have to do with this event, for example, a transfer from account A to account C, in that case, the variables A and C, that all of them have been recorded, or that none of them has been recorded. So the way that you can think of this is that the snapshot is like a wave that sloshes across the system, and you have to decide when you're going to execute a new event, a new action, a new statement. You have to decide which side of that fence is it going to be on. Is it going to be in the state where things have been recorded already, or is this changing the state that will soon be recorded? But you shouldn't take something that's been recorded and some other things that have not been, because in that case you might not get the consistent view of the system. So that's what rule R says. Okay, so if we just look at the examples, so this was the first example, that the one that we did not like. And so can you see where rule R is violated? So we have the three events. So we can look at them in order. I realized I put the little snapshot marker that actually happened after the event. So here the blue event happens first, and then we take a snapshot of this. So that means that the blue event happened before the snapshot. That is, we think of it in our mind as having happened before the snapshot. So that one is OK. This one transfers from B to C. And does it satisfy rule R?
B has
not been recorded. Right. B has not been recorded, but C has. So this is a violation of rule R.
It's difficult, though, to say specifically where rule R is valid, because what you're looking for is some arbitrary witness that, you know, of prefix and postfix and rule R. So it's the combination of all of these that's violated. I don't think you can put your finger exactly on like
so if, if the conceptual history remembers which things have been recorded, I claim you can. I mean, it could be that some states stay the same, and there could be ambiguity in that sense.
Right,
but
so you're giving us more information by putting these little cameras there. Like,
that's
if you're
right,
just giving the values, then you don't
right.
That.
Yeah, right. That's right. Yeah, you would, could you? I don't know, yeah, but I'm giving you the cameras, right, yeah. Okay, so if you were to think of how are you going to fix this algorithm? That is, if you have an algorithm that that can detect essentially the cameras, that is, when it's going to execute something like the green transaction here, the green event, it involves variables B and C. So again, I've said before that, well, if you're going to do that transfer at all, you need to lock something in the system so that you can get exclusive access to B and C. And I'm not thinking about that here, but if we just think that for a moment in time, we can look at B and C. So, well, we can then check, have B and C been recorded? And in this case, we notice, wait a minute, C has been recorded, but not B. So what we could do at that moment in the algorithm is we could just decide at that moment, let's go and record B now. So if we recorded B here and then did the transaction, then we would be fine. Then we've essentially moved this the green thing to on the other side of the line so that it's in the recorded setting, that is when the variables have been recorded. So in other words, we would think of this as executing after the snapshot took place. So it's being on the line that we want to avoid. Yep.
So the snapshot can be a strict subset of all accounts, right? It will not
yes.
need to record all the the balance of currently all the accounts.
That's right. Eventually, we'd like to record everything, right? But at any moment in time, it could be a subset, right? But rule R says all of the variables in for the statement that we're executing should all be recorded or all not be recorded. Right? So so for the first one, when we executed that one, then neither was recorded. Of course, we could decide at that point too, well, neither has been recorded, but let's just record both. That would be fine too. I mean, if you're in a state where you're recording snapshots, you could do that as well. That would be correct with respect to rule R. But the one that you want to avoid is where you have some variables have been recorded and some that have not been. You could think of variations of rule R that would say, what about as long as all of the variables that are being read by the statement, as long as they have all been recorded or all not been recorded, is that correct? Or you can think about what about if you consider all of the ones that the statement writes, and is that correct? And I'll let you think about that here or later, but let me press on. Okay, so this is the one that violates rule R. So here was the second example. So this one satisfies rule R. When we transfer from A to C, neither has been recorded. Here we transfer from B to D, and at that point, both have been recorded. And here C to A again, at the moment that the transaction takes place, neither has been recorded. And then immediately afterwards, I put the cameras here. And then D to B, that happens afterwards. So this one satisfies rule R.
So in a more general, I mean, this is the standard like transactional updating of multiple items in a database. And, mm-hmm. and usually, I mean, the only difference here is that you're sort of only thinking at read-only transactions that read the whole system.
In that system, you're saying?
In the problem you're considering. But usually, this is like everything is considered together, like the problem of updating these atomically. Mm-hmm. Or reading them atomically, it's all like the same problem and it's
That's
solved
true.
Together.
That's true. So here I'm assuming, for the example, that the updating happens atomically for some other reason, right? But that at least only needs to lock the variables involved. You don't have to lock down the entire system.
Okay. But you're assuming it's being locked like it's a pessimistic
That's right.
kind
of. Right. Or that the things happen, but maybe there are rollbacks if it doesn't complete or something like that.
But I mean, it's kind of important to think of both of these because you can't solve one of them without knowing how the other one works.
Okay. Yep. So that's that, and then we had this one, which allowed the reordering, and we can think about whether or not that also satisfies rule R. But let me press on. So I'm not going to say much about the actual formal proving of correctness. But I do want to mention this part. So if you want to prove that condition that we had before, that there exists a U of E that take you from the initial state to the recorded state and from there to the current state, a way to prove that is using the following invariant. So you may know already, or you may have learned from previous Dr. TLA Plus series, that an invariant is something that you check holds initially. And then with every step of the system, you check that it's maintained. And that means that you can rely on it holding in all states, just like you can in mathematical induction. So for the purpose of what I'm saying on this slide, I'm defining x partial, where x is some variable, to say that if x has been recorded, that is, if the recording is done, then pick the recorded value. Otherwise, pick the actual value. So I'm defining it just for the purpose on this slide, that is, there's nothing in the system that's going to go and do this. Well, you could write it if you want to, but just for the slide, so x partial, it looks at the recorded state if it's there, and otherwise it looks at the current state. So if you make sure not only that there exists U and V such that you can go from the initial to the recorded to the current state, but if you also make sure that as an invariant that you can go from the initial state, and here I should have said partial state, to the partial state, and then from the partial state to the current state, and you also make sure that this state V has to do with things that have been recorded, then you can prove correctness of rule R. And the nice thing about that is that then if you have another algorithm, you just need to make sure that your algorithm satisfies rule R and you're done. Because then we've proved once and for all that any system that satisfies rule R is correct. And I'm not going to go through this proof, but I will say that the partition here of the U and V follows that intuition that we have split the system, that some actions happen when in the states, that is, the transactions happen before the recording. That is, they take place before the snapshot, and all of these take place after the snapshot. And that's why we somehow sometimes may need to delay an action and do some recording so that we can put it flat on that side and not straddle both sides. The proof of this comes down to that if what rule R then says is that everything is recorded or everything has not been recorded. So if it has not been recorded, then it's not anything that V depends on. That is, the V is not going to read or write the variables if they have not been recorded. And therefore, it's okay to imagine that even if the action did take place after the U's and V's that we've recorded so far, we can consider commuting it to put it at the end of U instead of at the end of V. Okay, so I won't go into more of that, but let me instead stay with the algorithms. So, okay, I will tell you one more algorithm, and this algorithm is interesting. It was designed by Mandy Chandy and Leslie Lamport. There's a little nice blurb on Leslie's page. Leslie has little notes about papers he has written and where things came from and acknowledgments about various things. And you can go and read it yourself. So I'm going to explain to you the Chandy and Lamport algorithm for taking a snapshot in a distributed system with channels. So if you have a system that is distributed and you have channels between them, or even if it's on one system but the processes communicate using channels, then you can more easily record the state of a process, because the process, if you think of it as a CPU, you turn off interrupts maybe or whatever, you stop the processor and you record the state, and you can just read all that memory. But with a channel, you can't like stop a channel in the same way. Luckily, what you can do is you can record the state of a channel, you can compute it. If the sender remembers all of the messages that have been sent, and the receiver remembers all messages that have been received, then when you take the snapshot of just the CPUs themselves, the processors themselves, that is everything but the channels, you can then compute what must have been in the channel, because you can look at what was sent and wasn't received. But of course, doing this would be rather inefficient, right? I mean, you don't want to record everything that has ever been sent. In some systems, perhaps you do for other reasons, for logging purposes. So there's a little trick. And the trick is what the Chandy and Lamport algorithm does. And it does that using some markers. So what I'm going to do is show you in the PowerPoint how this algorithm works. And of course, it will be on one example. Okay, so here we see a system of four processors. And the blue arrows between them are channels. And there are some messages in flight on these channels, as you can see. And there's also some state that I haven't pictured in any particular way. And I marked one of the processes as the starting process, the one that's going to initiate the snapshot. You can do this in different ways, but it's convenient just to say that there's going to be one of these. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take a marker and pass it to the process that's going to begin taking the snapshot. What a process does when it receives a marker depends on whether or not it's the first marker it ever received. So if it's the first marker that it ever receives, then it will do the following. It will record the state of the process. So it will, and to do that, it has to then halt the process. It records the state of the process, and it will send out markers along all of the outgoing channels. It will listen on all of the incoming channels to wait until it receives a marker. Okay, so that's what a process does when it receives a marker for the first time. Okay, so now we have to imagine that the execution continues in some way. So for example, maybe this message up here is delivered, and here it looked like it was absorbed into this process just because, so this process changed its state somehow. It received that message. And maybe it sends another message. So that message being sent while the first process here is waiting for the marker, at this point, this process records that it has received that message. That is, it's something that's been received while it's waiting for the marker. Okay, so more things go on. Here, another message was processed, and the marker eventually arrives at a new process. So what this process is then going to do is it's going to record its own state, and it's going to send markers on all outgoing channels, and it's also going to listen on all incoming channels for a marker. But in fact, it has no more incoming channels. So in its snapshot, it will have recorded here for the incoming channel that there were no messages on it. That is, it's as if this process got its snapshot after, at the time when the channel was empty. Even though, of course, this process may be continuing to execute, and it may have put more messages into this channel, but that's okay. They will just not be part of the channel, according to rule R as well. Okay, so the system goes on. So the a marker gets delivered to yet another new process, and it takes a snapshot and sends another marker along all outgoing channels. And we see the same thing here. So at this point, there are there's an incoming channel again. So we hit listen to that channel waiting for a marker. Okay, so here we imagine that this marker is sent. So now is the first time in the example that we've seen that a channel, a process waiting for a marker on an incoming channel receives one. So all of the messages that were received before that mailbox picture was put up there and until the marker was actually received, all of those are recorded as being part of the snapshot over here. Okay. And then for the final channel here in the example, eventually these messages will be delivered. And because the marker has not been received and the channel is listening for the marker, they will be recorded as part of that snapshot. In other words, they will be recorded as if that channel then had those two messages. And that's the Chanyon and Lamport algorithm in a nutshell. Okay, any questions about that?
So, yep. Yeah, I'm trying to understand what, I mean, I don't fully get what the goal is and what we're doing. So earlier on we had this notion of event that has several smaller pieces, and you want to rule our, it says atomically, you know, this larger level event should atomically correspond to the level. Like in this picture, what is the larger event and what is the smaller event?
Right. So in this, you could still imagine that there are external events coming in, and I did not show them.
So
that is
an external request into the system.
That's right.
With a response or just a request?
Does it matter? It's something affects the system in some way so that a process decides to take some action.
Okay, so there's something coming in, and then in response to that, it propagates through the system somehow.
Right. And or it could be if it's a computation that just computes for a while and doesn't, I mean, get any external.
So computations, usually you would expect that they return a value in the end.
That's right, yeah.
As opposed to, you know, some update may just update a state somewhere without returning.
So maybe this system here is still computing. Maybe it will compute forever if it, I mean, maybe it just responds to requests. For
example. The smaller event here would be updates of the states of these individual pieces,
includes
sending or receiving a message.
The way that I pictured for this is that it's not going to include the little events on each process, but you could also take snapshots on each process. But if that's not a distributed system, it's easier to do. So just imagine that what the thing that's recorded here is the entire state of that process, which then may include things that it has responded to the outside, things that
it doesn't include, like message inboxes or outboxes.
To the external world, you could do that. But for the communication that's being done between these processes, then the recording that's done is, as I've shown you in the algorithm here. So because what you'd like to do is you'd like to, if you want to, I mean, take a snapshot of this system, you'd like to know what are messages that are on different channels. And the way that this algorithm achieves that is by propagating markers through the system. And the markers provide this sort of wave that rule R tells you about, that things are recorded on one side and not recorded on the other side.
But you're assuming there's only one event incoming from the outside.
You mean, that's right, in this example I did, right, yeah, right. So if there were also more events coming from the outside, then just like in the bank example, we have to decide, do we record those events or do we just take action from the states and to record what's going on? So, right, I guess, so for this example, it's easier to think of that the system is computing something by itself. There are no other further external events. And we still want to take a snapshot of it. So in that sense, you could even think of that the messages that are being passed are requests to transfer balances, perhaps. And how a process decides that it's going to change a balance of something, maybe that's some sort of stock market program decides, oh, it's good to sell this and buy this at this point, or whatever it might be.
Because trying to map this to any real problem I might have in my systems, and I find it difficult. So the only thing that works for me right now is I'm debugging my system and in a test environment, and I'm injecting a request, and I want to be very precise about knowing, you know, which state was hit in what node and what happened in this execution. I can see it working for that. But in any like production environment, there would never be just one request coming in, right? I would have the situation.
That's right. Yes, so there would be more requests. The marker coming in here is the one that initiates a snapshot. But there could then be other requests coming in from the system that I have not shown in the slide.
Okay.
So the debugging is a good example of a place where you would want to have some consistent snapshot. But there you have to then read the specification carefully of your snapshot algorithm, because again, you may then be looking at the state that didn't actually occur. So you need to be satisfied. You need to think, are you satisfied with looking at the state that could have occurred from the initial states and that leads to whatever the state is actually in now? Thank you.
So I was going to ask another question. I think, just following up what the Sebastian was saying. So you could have multiple requests coming in, and then that greenish mark comes in. At that point, you decide everything before that needs to be recorded. Everything after that, you don't care for this particular snapshot.
Right? That's right, right.
And then, okay, so this is the time this guy records its state, mm-hmm. and it passes this mark out.
Right.
And then it also observes things coming in from that incoming channel.
Right.
And then it keeps recording all the messages coming in mm-hmm. until it sees another mark coming in and they say, forget about this channel, I don't care about that anymore.
That's right. Once it gets another marker coming in, mm-hmm. then it's done recording. Then it can just resume computing as it did.
Got it. So then you do this for every incoming channel. Suppose there is another channel from the left bottom corner up, then you do that for that one as well.
That's correct. Right.
So then you are done until every channel is...
That's right. So you're done when there's a big camera in each box and where every channel also has a little camera. I didn't actually put the little cameras on the ones that have just one incoming one, but yes, that's right. So you're not... So when a process like this one records its local snapshot, it's not quite done yet. It can continue computing. That is, it doesn't have to halt itself any longer, but it's not done recording information for the snapshot because it needs to wait for this channel to clear enough so that the marker will come through. Because when the marker comes through, then you know which side of the recording each message on that channel would have been on. All right. Okay. So let me wrap up. So I've told you about global snapshots. So global snapshots again can be used in for a variety of things like checkpointing, like debugging, like detecting deadlocks and so forth. If you have a system with channels, you don't have to be too worried about that it's difficult to record the state of a channel, because there are algorithms that let you do that as well, like sending markers along the channels. Or more generally, even though it's inefficient, you can conceptually think of it as the sender and receiver record what they have sent and received, and then you compute from that what the channel actually contains. And finally, rule R that I mentioned, which is essentially saying that you should think of everything that happens in the system as either happening before the snapshot, before you record its variables, or afterwards. And if you're ever on the fence in between, then what you can do is go ahead at that moment and record those variables that have not yet been recorded, and then proceed with taking action. So that's what I have to say about those. But let me leave you with two other little plugs. So if you're interested in more formal things and learning how to specify and verify programs and systems, you may be interested in looking at my Verification Corner channel on YouTube. And also, it's occurred to me that Jean-Romand Abrial was here, I think it was in 2011, and visiting for a number of weeks. And as part of those weeks, he gave, I think it was 5 lectures in the on event B. So event B is not exactly TLA plus. There are several systems that are similar in that they organize the your thinking into events that happen, and you can abstract from the actual system in terms of these events. The unity formalism that Chandy and Misra used in their book is also similar in that sense. TLA plus and the action systems and event B, and there's also a tool for event B as well. So you can learn things from that as well, even if you don't use event B. And so look at those. I think they should be on ResNet. I didn't look for the URL, but they were recorded as such. All right, so with that, thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take further questions that you may have.
Can you briefly talk about how you are going to detect data logs using global snapshots?
Right.
How you are going to define data logs?
Right. So here's what you can do. If we take this picture, right? So take a global snapshot, consistent snapshot of the system. Now that we have this global snapshot, we can now go and look at the pieces of that in our leisure. That is, we don't have to worry about incoming messages and whatnot. So if we now see that maybe some part of this process is waiting for a lock, a mutual exclusion lock, let's say. But it's waiting for one lock while it's holding another. And maybe we detect that this process holds that other lock, but is waiting for the one. So if we can then, if we have a global snapshot of a system, we can go and see which locks are held by which processor, and which locks is each process waiting for. And then we can detect cycles among those to detect deadlocks.
But they are taken from different time.
Well, again, we have to believe the specification that we're writing down for the system. So if you detect, so if I go back to, if we detect a, to this. If in the recorded state we detect that there is a deadlock, remember that the recorded state then is something that, well, maybe it didn't actually occur. We could have gotten there. But if we detect the deadlock there, a deadlock is something that you never get out of. So if it exists here, then it also exists in the current state. Because our specification says that there is a way to get from the recorded state to the current state. So that's why it's OK to look in the recorded state. For the deadlock. But of course, it could have been that the deadlock occurred right here and we didn't capture it in our snapshot. Well, I mean, if you're looking for deadlocks, you would probably do this periodically. So the next time around, you'll find it. Right. So I think, trusting in specifications in general, but in this specification, it's really important that it's important to get that specification right to test the specification against scenarios like this to see, is this really a specification that we'd be happy with?
So I guess another question would be, so if you look at the Chandler-Lamport algorithm, and then I'm wondering, you're going to write a specification to show whether that's people verify whether that's actually working correctly or not. Like in general, how would you actually approach that?
The general strategy, it could be several different strategies, but if we can show that that algorithm satisfies rule R, then we're done. Because, you can prove separately that anything that satisfies rule R also satisfies. Actually, what you do is you prove that the system satisfies rule R, then you show that a system that satisfies rule R and satisfies this invariant, such a system satisfies this invariant, and then you know that the specification holds. So
rule R is a sufficient condition.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It's not necessary.
But I don't even know what the rule R means here, because I mean...
So in that case, so let's see. So what does rule R mean in terms of, that is, remember, rule R speaks about variables. So we then have to think of, the variables would be the entire systems here, unless we care to have a finer granularity. And the channel state is a variable as well. So when a process is sitting here and it's about to send a message, it's updating its green state to, in some way, and it's also updating the state of this channel. So that means, so what we'd like to do then is think of it, that action that takes place is something that modifies variables both here and here. And in fact, if we model both of those as one variable, there are two variables that this action modifies. Okay. And so rule R then says we need to make sure that both of those happen before the snapshot or both happen after the snapshot. And
I think now I understand better what the whole thing, like, it has to do with what was the bigger event and the smaller events. And the bigger event is the atomic transition where a node atomically transitions to a new state and sends a message, or atomically receives a message and transitions. So those are the atomicity things that you need to guarantee. So it's much smaller than I thought.
Like, I see. Okay. Well, that's
completely misunderstood, because I had sort of this idea that the large event is like some request coming in, and that the smaller events are all the distributed activity in the system, which is not what this is.
Right. Okay, yeah, so I'm glad that you're satisfied with that then, right? Yeah, so if you think of it as sort of an actor system that only responds to, I mean, it receives some stuff, does some computation, and then sends that stuff out, then those could be, I mean, smaller things to think about, right? But if you then model things as one variable per green blob and one variable per blue arrow here, you can then see how rule R fits in. And let's take one example. So with this one down here, that message that came in, that was something that was modifying that the incoming channel and the green blob here that received it. Well, both of those happened before the snapshot was taken. And then here, when it receives the marker, at that point, it takes the snapshot. So anything that happens afterwards in this processor is then going to be considered to be taking place afterwards. So you can see that now if this processor reads more things from here, it reads that variable and that variable, if you think of them as variables, and both of those have already been recorded, so it's fine.
So I guess this would be one level, right? So you assume this atomic operation between the two processes, and either you record that atomically or you don't record that at all.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And then I guess the next step would be, for practical purpose, you could break this atomic operations out to like sending and then receiving, and not atomic.
That's right. And sending and receiving is nice in the sense that the if this process sends on the message, you don't have to lock the, of course, at some point, I mean, something has to be locked in the channel, but writing can happen sort of concurrently with the reading from the channel. So that variable that is between, you don't have to first go and compete for lock for that. But the enqueuing and dequeuing of the channel take care of that.
Right. In the TLA specification side, every time only one action takes time.
That's right.
So it's
right.
The same.
Which is a beautiful abstraction. And in fact, all of these systems that I mentioned that are similar in some ways, they give you that abstraction. And you decide when you write an action in TLA+, how many things is this thing allowed to do? That is it allowed to both update its internal state and put something on the channel? Or does it have to first update its state and then compete for the channel and then maybe update something in another process? So that granularity is all up to you. You model that in the language. It would be very nice to have the modeling component of of TLA plus and other systems. Ken McMillan and I are thinking about doing a lecture series at Microsoft on formal methods that would then teach more of those techniques as well. That is, how you have a certain problem, how do you actually encode it? And that's done in different tools, and that's a great thing to do because you have to abstract, and that process of abstraction just is such a useful thing for us as software engineers to do anyhow. So it's a good thinking skill to have, even if you're not, I mean, doing all the proofs formally.
This whole system of fault processes deterministic or non-deterministic?
I was not assuming that it's deterministic. It's I was thinking that it's highly non-deterministic, and asynchronous, and right. But the general specification again is okay with that, because if the actual execution took a particular number of choices through all of that non-determinism, it's okay if the recorded state looks like it went through a different sequence of things, as long as you can get to it and from it to the current state.
So I think I now understand, and I see the attraction really is that here's a problem that you're not sure you could even solve easily, and there's an easy solution. Yes, now we can do this. I still don't know why I would really want to do this in any practical situation.
Uh-huh, right, yeah.
But,
well, that's good. Any time we encounter something we think we cannot do and then see it can be done, it opens some doors for us.
So we can take this offline, but actually when we are scheduling this particular lecture, there are more than one group internally told us they are investigating or started implementing a global snapshot mechanism.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there are actually, it turns out, to be practical scenarios they need to do this.
Great. But should I say something about the next lecture, or do you know the... I don't know. Well, there will be a next lecture.
Right. Next lecture is about bilentine fault tolerance by Dr. Schreimel from NYU. And then after that will be Stefan, termination detection, I think.
Oh, great. See, you have another question.
In this flow, each system receives a marker. The markers propagate with the whole system. Let's say if the third one, when it receives a marker and then it will pass to the fourth one. And what if there is another channel established from the first one and the third one? And at this time, the third one will send two markers, right?
That's right.
Then in this case, could it be possible that the markers may be grow exponentially in the whole system?
No. Through the course of taking the snapshot, there will be exactly one marker passed along every channel.
If the third one.
Yeah.
Now, it will send to the fourth one, and also it need to send back to the first one. What if there's
another? So suppose that this, you're saying, if this process has not just one outgoing channel here, but also another one going over there, when it receives its marker along here, it would record its own state and then send the marker along each.
So there are two markers now.
That's right. There are two markers now, one that direction and one direction. And actually there's a third one. This one is still there, right? So when this one, when that marker arrives here, because this is a process that has already received a marker, there's a difference in what the process does the first time it receives a marker and the other times that it receives a marker. So then when this marker comes back, actually it is like when this marker is sent here, right? When it arrives here, at that point, this process does not send any more markers. It only records, now it knows everything that was on this channel, because this channel has really been like flushed, you can think of it as. So, but it's not going to send any more markers. So the number of markers sent is just exactly one per channel.
Mm-hmm. And I think, probably from practical perspective, the guy on the left corner does need to receive a marker from any other guys, right? Because otherwise it doesn't know whether that channel even existed. By receiving a marker from everyone, then it knows, okay, every guy has been kind of cleared, right?
That's right. Yeah, in this picture, I did not. I abstracted over that as well to say the, right. So if the markers could be, if the channels could be constructed more more ad hoc, you'd have to think about that. So here I was assuming that you know where the incoming ones are, so that you know when to sit and listen and record until you get the marker there.
And then there could be message losses on the channel and a reorder. Right? So I guess there's a follow-up algorithms actually along this line of work to address all these archetypal issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Yeah.
But again, hopefully this serves like a very good like baseline for us to start looking into this direction and have some kind of formal treatment about this problem.
I have an idea on where this could also be useful. But in the context where you have a high-level protocol description, like in TLA, mm-hmm. and then you have a real implementation of it, and you're just not quite sure that there wasn't a mistake made somewhere along the way.
Mm-hmm.
So with this, you can take a snapshot of the state
mm-hmm.
and check the invariant right, mm-hmm. periodically. So mm-hmm. you will like detect if a mistake has crept in somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Could give some confidence.
That's right. Because again, if you find that the invariant does not hold, then there's at least, since there was a way to get from the initial state to here, there's some error in your program.
Right.
Right. So whether or not that error occurred on that execution, we don't know. But it shows an error in the program.
And I think it would be helpful if you're in the process of doing this, just to get confidence that you're not making mistakes and catching them early on. You might not need to run this in production in the end, but mm-hmm. just in the process of doing this.
Mm-hmm.
Could catch a lot of bugs, I'm sure, mm-hmm. just in.
It's like doing global assertion on a global
snapshot. Yeah, exactly.
Snapshot.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yes,
that's
right. When you record the states, will this action actually impact the variables?
No. So this is a convenient slide to have. So if you think of there as being in the original system, there was a bunch of variables like x. Then you add to that variables x recorded and x done. So x done is just a bit, a boolean that says whether or not it's been done. And x recorded would be the same type as x. That is, if x denotes the entire address space of your process, then x recorded also is the same big variable, right? But again, of course, you don't actually record, all of the, let's say, 2 to the 32, words or bytes in the system. You would have some process of recording things more incrementally. But conceptually, x recorded doubles the state. So you double a state plus add a bit for, and then if you, since you decide, where should all of these variables be? What's the granularity? So however you decide to split it, the recorded are always going to be doubling the size. But if you have a fine-grained system, you're going to have a lot of done bits. But that also gives you finer granularity in the concurrency of it. All right.
Okay,
well,
great.
Thank you very much.
See you again.